I'd like to present the recent results of the study which we've been working on recently about the fabrication and characterization of the 16 stainless steel components obtained via a pretty innovative technique, which is material extrusion additive manufacturing. So, in the presentation, I will give a brief description of the process, and then I'll show the main issues related to the fabrication of the specimens, and the results of the kind of tests that we perform, which are tests and stick tests, and then I can go for some quick final remarks. First of all, material extrusion additive manufacturing is the general term which is used in the literature to refer to a multi-phase process, which steps are shaping, the binding, the shaping part is inspired by the FDM additive manufacturing. In fact, we use a regular FDM filter. But the filament is not the usual polymeric filament, but it's a special blend, which is called ion-film polymer. And basically, it's a mixture of metal powder in polymeric matrix. Since the final aim is to obtain a metal part, it's necessary to bind the part, to remove the binder, the polymeric part, and then the specimens are sintered to allow the metal particles to create the next bond and to densify the specimen. So the fabrication starts from the design of the models and the creation of the cheat codes through the slicer software, the cheat codes that the printer is able to read between the specimens. As you can see from the picture, we started from really simple shapes, basically boxes, both with 0% and 100% infill density. And this was pretty useful to understand first what are the most significant parameters in the printing phase, and to understand what are the suitable values for them. After the printing phase, in our case, we outsourced the binding and sintering to an external company. But here you have this schematic showing the treatment that the specimens underwent. So as I mentioned before, we started with really simple shapes and the printing process was pretty demanding. But finally we were able to print both fatigue and precise specimens according to the ASTM standard. And here I show the main printing parameters that we used, some of the main printing parameters. In particular, we want you to notice that the nozzle temperature is 295 degrees, which is pretty high, considering that for a regular PLA filament, for example, the temperature is around 200 degrees. One of the main issues that we experience with the printing part is related to the shrinkage. Because the specimens are supposed to shrink during the sintering process, therefore, it's important to design them over dimension. And that's what we did. We over-dimensioned specimens in order to be able to compensate a linear reduction of about 19% on the XY direction and 21% on the Z direction. These were suggested values in the literature. But what we found is that the specimen shrunk a lot more than expected, in particular on the Z direction, which in our case corresponds to the thickness of the specimens because we printed them flat on the Nevertheless, we performed some tensile tests, obtaining these stress strain curves and these static mechanical properties. The material appears to be pretty ductile because, for example, the elongation rate is above 40%, and you can see from these pictures that the specimens elongated a lot during the tests. Although there is no evident sign of friction corresponding to the fracture area, and the error reduction percentage is around 30%. We also wanted to compare our data with some other works about the same material, 316L, produced with the same technique. And we find out that our data are pretty in good agreement both for the strength and for the ductility of the material. We also performed some fatigue tests. This is the stress cycle score that we obtained. We started from a stress amplitude of 300 MPa, which was apparently pretty high since the specimen broke early in the low cycle regime. And from the SEM picture, for example, it was difficult to see clear significant fatigue patterns. increasing the amplitude was easier and easier. And for example, these specimens, this is the fracture surface of the specimen that worked at an amplitude of 100 MPa. And we were able to see both crackle initiation sites, large flat areas that corresponds to the stable crack growth area, and then the transition to the ductal area corresponding to the ultimate rupture. We also wanted to compare our curve with other curves, and we decided to present these two trends of the work about metal-enriched molding. So the material is the same, it's 316L, but the fabrication process is different. But metal-enriched molding has several similarities with material extrusion with thermal puttering. For example, the feedstock material is the same because it's a blend of metal powder and polymer. And then after the shaping part, the specimens undergoes the binding and sintering process. So the microstructure can be similar to the one of the material extrusion at the thermal pattern of the specimens. What we found is that the fatigue limit of our specimens is still below the one of the metal injection specimens. Now I'd like to go back to this slide because, as I mentioned before, we saw several initiation sites, but these are not on the external surface of the specimens, but they start from some big voids inside the specimen. The porosity is one of the main issues of this technique. We can distinguish between two types of porosity, the macro porosity and so-called micro porosity. In this case, the what we mean with macro porosity is the pores that are due to the printing process itself. So basically, layering the material, the substratification of the layers creates these voids, and the distribution, the shape, if they are communicant or not, this all depends on the infill strategy. And in our case, we decided to create the specimen with two walls, two external walls, and an infill strategy rectilinear with a raster angle of plus minus 45 degrees, which is pretty conventional. So here I have a couple of examples of these macro pores. In the first pictures, the pores are inside the specimen, so in the infill, and they are pretty irregular and not spherical at all. While in the second pictures, we have the pores in the boundaries between the wall and the infill, and these are more regular and more spherical. And this was for the macro porosity, the so-called macro porosity. While for the micro porosity, we refer to these little pores, really spherical regular, that we observe all over the fracture surface. And these are probably due mainly to the debinding and sintering process, when these processes are not 100% successful. And besides the macro porosity, the final density, the full density is not achieved. Okay, so some final remarks. The results that we obtain are promising, so it is worth to have further study on this topic. But what was important of this study is that we understood that the density and the porosity of the specimens is important, and we have to improve the printing strategy to try to close at least the macro porosity. Then it would be important, in my opinion, to repeat the test to see how much the density and porosity has an impact on the mechanical behavior of the specimens. And it would be also interesting, in my opinion, to have a proper characterization of the material with the test, not only mechanical, but also